evening. We will call the regular Board of Education meeting to order and have roll call, please.
Dyke.
Here.
Walker.
Here.
Frisbee.
Here.
Maycomber.
Here.
Winery.
Here.
We'll have the reading of the mission statement by Director Frisbee, please.
Our mission is to encourage, inspire, and empower students and staff in order to maximize learning.
Thank you. Agenda item three is the approval of the agenda. Do we have any additions or corrections, Dr. Cox?
We do. We have one additional resignation, Linda Brandt as head drama. And then I would ask to table item number four. Dylan's grandmother passed away this morning, and so he is not here with us tonight.
I move to approve the agenda as amended.
I'll second it.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the agenda as amended. Roll call vote, please.
Frisbee.
Yes.
Maycomber.
Yes.
Winery.
Yes.
Walker.
Yes.
Dyke.
Yes. Motion carried 5-0. Agenda item five is to welcome visitors and ask for public comment. As we begin our agenda tonight, I'll explain our process for public comment. The board will hear comments from the public in conjunction with each agenda item using a structured process. As board president, I will ask for comments when we reach that item on the agenda. You will be asked to approach the microphone, state your name, and limit your comments to 2 minutes. At this time, I invite any member of the audience to step up to the microphone with comments about items of interest or concern that do not appear on tonight's agenda. Please begin by stating your name and contact information. It would be appreciated if you would limit your comments to 2 minutes so that we can keep the meeting moving in a timely fashion and allow others an opportunity to speak, as well as allowing the board to complete the full board agenda in a timely manner. Comments from the public are limited to matters within the board's authority. Please understand that we as a board cannot discuss items not already on the agenda. Iowa Sunshine Law prohibits us from having a discussion without the proper notice to all of the school district community that the issue would be discussed at tonight's board meeting. Also, please remember you are making comments in a public meeting. Should you make comments that the subject of the comments considers to be inflammatory or libelous, you as an individual may be subject to legal action brought by the subject of your comments. We thank you for your support of our school district. Are there any comments from the public this evening?
My name is Joseph Sider. I've already given you these, but I've printed off these for you, so I'll hand these out for you. Thank you. It's going to be longer than 2 minutes, so I'm just going to read a couple of paragraphs just to reiterate. In talking to members of the community this week, I have had a few different ideas feed at me about what people would like to see with the old middle school. And my first and foremost issue that I would like to see that's most important to me would be for me to umbrella under Jordan River, a nonprofit who helps our communities hungry, collect the funds needed to buy and renovate the building, to begin both a homeless shelter, transitional housing, and community kitchen that I would like to see it become. Obviously, that would take a lot of hard work and money, but I believe it could be accomplished. Enlisting churches, organizations, businesses, and members of our community on a volunteer basis, along with funds and grants and donations from within and around our community. I believe that this is more than possible because of the positive feedback and willingness to volunteer that I've encountered just over the last week as I've begun to embark on my tour. And I also feel that I must tell you that I have discovered something amazing over the last week, and that is the heart of the community. Everyone that I have talked to about starting up a homeless shelter has supported the idea. So many people have ideas and want to help, but most don't know how. However, when you tell them what you want done and start asking for help and assigning tasks, they will gladly jump in and help. Perhaps it is fear that stops us in lack of education. Starting a homeless shelter is something I've wanted to do since I was 18, but first I need to get my life together, and once I wasn't so scruffy looking, I wanted to do something, but I didn't know where to start, and I was scared. I'm not a public speaker and probably shook while reading this. When I first emailed the school board and started talking to people, I expected to be mocked or criticized, but I wasn't, and that has helped push me forward. Certainly, I am new to all this, and to be honest, have a faint idea about what I'm doing, but I do believe in the heart of the community, and I believe that if we each put our best foot forward and work together, we can find a way to use this building to give back to the community and help those who may not be able to help themselves. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other comments from the public this evening? Hearing none, we'll move on to agenda item. You want to, Mr. Wolf? Sorry. Just holler at me.
Thanks, Mr. Bain. Larry Wolf, Charles City High School Assistant Principal. Just want to give a shout out to everyone that was involved in the Northeast Iowa Conference on our band orchestra and choirs today. We had all of our brothers and sisters schools from the conference here at the high school and the middle school. The concert starts at 7 o'clock. But anyway, great event, great venue for us, and a great opportunity for us to blend our kids with other kids and have a great day.
Thank you, Mr. Wolf. Any other comments from the public? We'll move on to agenda item 6, comments by board members and superintendent, and we'll begin with Dr. Cox.
Thank you. First semester will end this Friday, and as a reminder, there's no school next Monday for students. Teachers have professional learning that day, and the second semester will begin on Tuesday. As Mr. Wolf has just stolen some thunder, tonight is the Northeast Iowa Conference Music Festival, and we have the privilege of hosting that once every 7 years, and so we welcome all of our brothers and sisters from Waukon, Decorah, Crestwood, Owen, Wiggly, Shutterrock, and New Hampton tonight for a pretty neat event. The board meeting actually will recess at 6:55. I'm going to walk down and welcome the crowd to the concert tonight, and then I'll be back hopefully shortly after 7, and then we'll continue with the board meeting. We received some feedback from the Iowa Association of School Boards regarding the two Charles City sessions that we had in November, and they both were very positive. The Swimming with the Sharks session scored a 4.5 out of 5, and the pre-conference workshop also a 4.5 out of 5. So we're proud of those Charles City board members and staff who took part in that. But we have special news to announce tonight. Dr. Ryan Wise, who is the director of the Iowa Department of Education, will be coming to Charles City to visit our school system on May the 12th. That's all I have is a date lockdown. We'll have some more details later this spring. We're excited to have Director Wise coming up here to Charles City to visit us. And lastly, the school board will be meeting in Floyd and in Caldwell this spring. So I want to get that on your calendars as well. The board will be in Floyd on April 24th. And in Caldwell on May 22nd.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Any board members with comments this evening?
I just wanted to note, I don't know if you folks had read the Charles City Press this past week about Iowa legislature starting their session today. And our two representatives, Todd Pritchard and Waylon Brown, are off and running today. And it was gratifying to me to read a lot of the comments that they had in the paper that were in sync with what we believe, what our culture is. And, you know, I can't help but think that we helped shape some of their ideas, especially with sharing this building with them and our philosophies and building something that's so unique. So hopefully it's a great session and we'll have some good work that comes out of there.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Any other comments from board members? We'll move on then to agenda item 7, committee reports. It says the only one that has a report for sure is SIAC, so Dr. Cox.
And the only report I have is that we will meet on Wednesday in the Iowa Big North location at the North Grand Building, and the meeting is from 5 to 6. It's always open to the public. And so that's our report. I'll have a more complete report in 2 weeks after we've had our meeting.
Buildings and grounds meets tomorrow morning.
I was talking to the assessor today, and they've scheduled, tentatively scheduled, a conference committee meeting January 25th on Wednesday.
Okay.
So we'll have a report next meeting after that.
Sometime soon, finance committee is meeting directly.
Correct.
And as far as the policy report, I believe Dr. Cox and administration have started to work on the request from the last meeting to gather some information, and we have an agenda item here tonight, so policy will be meeting shortly again as well. Agenda item 8, life-threatening allergy policy. This is a repeat of what we did at December 12th. We sought public input. Tonight we will consider action on the first reading of the policy. And actually, if you look in your handout, on the second page, in the blue type font, the policy committee is proposing that we add paragraph 10, which basically we took from Waukee out of their handbook for lunchroom procedures. And it sets up procedures that students and staff are encouraged to wash their hands. Elementary students who eat cold lunch will be required to wash their hands before they go to recess or back to the classroom. And let's see, elementary students, if you bring lunch from home, we would have a special table or area where those lunches would be eaten so as not to expose other students to food and or products that are brought from home in case they would happen to have allergy foods, primarily peanuts, that most people are concerned about. And so you've got that available to read the details of. Are there any questions from the board about that addition?
I'm glad to see those procedures because I felt that was missing, but knew that we would come up with procedures, so thank you.
I'm wondering if on number 10 and number B, should we, at the end of the first paragraph, or the first sentence, add by non-allergy students, just to clarify. I know that the second sentence goes on to explain that the allergy-threatened students will sit at the school lunch tables, but just to...
Double.
An extra, yeah, double emphasis there that the students with non-allergies will sit at these other tables. Otherwise, that's great.
Yeah, this kind of came from something that was brought up the last one, that this whole policy is, you know, it's no longer a ban per se, but discouraged, especially at the elementary levels. But like we talked about, if it's not a ban, inevitably it will show up in the lunchroom. And how will we respond to that, especially at the youngest levels? And I thought when we looked a little bit closer and I researched a little more with Waukee School District, this was some language that I thought seemed to address that fairly well. It is just primarily applicable to the elementary level. Here at the middle school, our lunch facilities, our lunch room is so flexible and spread out all over the place. I think that individual cases could be pretty easily addressed based on several different options. And then at the high school level, of course, our language in here addresses it in a different way. So.
I wonder, in A, we talk about how students and staff are encouraged to wash their hands with soap and water after eating and or handling food. But then when we go to E, we say lunchroom tables will be cleaned after each lunch shift. Now, does that, do we just want them to remove the trash, remove the food, or do we want those tables wiped down? Maybe we need to define cleaned.
Wiped down.
Well, I think we should say that.
Soapy water.
Or whatever.
Because cleaned up can mean a whole lot of things to a lot of people.
Oh, I see what you're saying, yeah.
You know, it can mean, well, I'm just gonna remove the trash and remove the lunch table, lunch trays.
But not sanitizing.
Right.
Maybe good word sanitizing.
Yeah.
Yeah, wiped down, sanitized.
After each lunch.
You know, and I'm sure this is a procedure.
Are we picking on words?
I'd say if we're gonna make too many changes to the wording, I would request that you move it back to the policy committee and not do anything with it tonight.
Okay.
Wrestle with some of the, keep suggesting things that you'd like to see.
Okay.
And Jason, Scott, take notes. I'll make some notes as well. But I would hate for us to try to fuss with it right now and approve a first reading that isn't really thought through as well as we want it to be.
That's a good point.
You need to have a new first reading on the revised language. Yeah.
And like we had talked before that these changes don't, you know, pushing it back doesn't set us back at any time. This doesn't become effective until July 1st, so we want to make sure you get it right and get it done the first time.
It is good, very good.
The other thing that was passed out of, this was gathered by, I believe, our nurse, right?
Yes,
the
2015.
The list from last year that had school districts around the state that were considered themselves under a ban versus being unaware and not safe. She had reached out to a number of districts around the state, and these were the ones that responded.
Can I make a motion that we not act on the first reading until we have...
You want to refer this back to policy committee?
Yeah, refer it back to policy committee to make some good changes.
You certainly can. Second to that motion?
I'll second that.
Any other comments or questions from the board? Any comments or questions from the public on this policy?
I'm good.
Okay.
Thank you.
Hearing none, we'll have roll call vote, please, on the motion to send this back to the policy committee.
Larry?
Yes.
Walker?
Yes.
Frisbee?
Yes.
Maycomber?
Yes.
Dyer?
Yes. Motion carried 5-0. And we're fine with you sending it back to us.
Yeah.
Like Jason said, we want to get it right, and we want to try and make this as easy of a transition moving forward this summer and next fall as possible. Agenda item 9 is the strategic plan for the school district. Is this what you were going to talk about then?
It is.
Can you do it in 5 minutes?
Can you do it in 5 minutes?
I cannot, but I can start it.
Okay, you can start, and then we'll take a recess when you need to leave.
So in front of us and behind the audience, you can see on the screen that we have the strategic plan of the Charles City Community Schools. This is a draft, and so I want you to keep that in mind. If there are things that you see that you would like to tweak or revise, or if you have questions about, this is the time to do so. If the public has some input that they would like to offer as well, you know, we can take that additionally over the course of the next 10 days or so. Strategic plan goal areas, you'll see at the center of it, it's to become a destination district. And that's the mantra that I keep hearing from our board, that we want Charles City to become a place that others are aspiring to attend. And around that, you'll see 5 goal areas: high academic achievement, culture, climate, and environment, effective communication, fiscal responsibility and stability, and facilities for educational excellence. So the process that has taken place over the past 14, 15 months started in September of 2015 and has kind of come to a conclusion in December of 2016. And through that process, there have been several focus groups. The board was one of the focus groups here recently. You'll see School Improvement Advisory Committee, or SIAC, in the center of that. The needs assessment that we recently conducted in November of 2016 as well. So quite a few folks have had a chance to say, here's what I think is important in the Charles City schools. Here's what I'd like to see us focus upon. And that has brought us to the strategic plan that you see. There are some current realities in place and some strategic assumptions for the next 5 years. And that's the time frame that I chose to develop the strategic plan, is 5 years. I think it's important to revisit it periodically. A 10-year one, I think, would be too long for us, but we want to be mindful of where are we headed in a longer term than just the next 12 months. So here are some things that are either current realities or strategic assumptions. First, we'll talk political. Vouchers, charter schools, education savings accounts, we're going to hear about that starting tomorrow. We're going to hear about that this week here in the state of Iowa. You're hearing about this nationally as well with the nomination of Betsy DeVos as Secretary of Education. Collective bargaining changes are coming, with Republicans having the House and the Senate, both here in Iowa and nationally. Here in Iowa, all indications are that there are big changes, not just some subtle tweaking coming. That will impact our strategic plan. CTE, or Career and Technical Education, Programming and Delivery, House File 2392 from last year, puts in place a really different approach to how CTE will be delivered, and that impacts us as a school district. We have some school funding current realities and assumptions that are made over the course of the next 5 years. A 0 to 2% increase in state aid, and tomorrow we should hear from the governor his recommendation. I would anticipate within the next 10 days that SSA will be set both for the coming year and the following one, so fiscal year 18 and 19. More school consolidations on the horizon as small increases in funding really strangle small rural districts. Categorical funding being loosened, and if you've been reading in the Register as well, there was talk just today from the Speaker of the House, Linda Uttmeyer from Clear Lake, about loosening up categorical funding and giving the school board more authority as to how funds are spent. Inequities being addressed, and the popular ones that you've heard are the inequities in the cost per pupil. Davenport has a lawyer in Davenport, and a bunch of people have joined in, have a lawsuit against the state of Iowa about the inequity. There's transportation inequity. There's a poverty inequity. So lots of inequities that are being discussed and challenged right now. Extension of the 1 cent sales tax is likely. It will set sunset in 2029 without an extension. I would think that either in this legislative session or by next year, that will have been extended for another 20 years. Economic. We assume that the new Charles City Middle School will attract and retain students. We have the impact of the McQuillan Place, the Allied Development, and the Parkside Development, bringing additional housing options for Charles Cityans and for people who are looking for jobs here that want to find a home in Charles City. Manufacturing jobs, and you may not know this, they're at an all-time high in Floyd County since the closure of the White Tractor Plant. And that was as of June 2016. It actually could be higher than that at this point. And Simply Essentials is adding up to 500 jobs in Charles City by the time we get to next summer. I see that it's 6:55, so I'll save the final one, which is demographic. Well, no, let's do this one quickly, and then we'll jump into the strategic plan. So the demographic assumption, strategic assumptions, and current realities, increase in the percent of non-Caucasian students, increase in the percent of students receiving free and reduced lunches, increase in the percentage of students with special needs, and the increase in the number of students receiving mental health counseling. So that's all part of what goes into what we're assuming based on current reality and what the trend is looking like for the next 5 years to put together this strategic plan. So I'll leave that graphic up for you. I'm going to head down and welcome everybody to Charles City. Be back in maybe 7 minutes.
I'll declare a short recess until Dr. Cox's return. Okay, the time is 7:05, and we will call the meeting back to order and continue on with the strategic plan for the school district.
All right, thank you. So the strategic plan goal areas, again, in front of you, high academic achievement, culture, climate, and environment, effective communication, fiscal responsibility and stability, and facilities for educational excellence. High academic achievement, strategies, we'll talk about first, and then indicators of success. So the strategies, that, as you see on the PowerPoint in front of you, and I apologize for all of the words, I would reduce it, but for people who are going to look at this afterward or online, you need more of the detail. Expand personalized learning experiences. Expand student-centered environments. Create more real-world opportunities like project-based learning, job shadowing, and internships for students. Those first three things should look familiar to you. They come straight out of our vision statement. The fourth bullet, more frequent coaching, feedback, and training for teachers. You know, our mission statement is unlike many other schools in that we treat students and staff equally. Our mission is to engage, inspire, and empower students and staff. Our vision statement also speaks to students and staff, and so helping our teaching staff with more frequent coaching, feedback, and training is important and part of this plan. Enhancing assessments for learning, so along the way instead of just at the end, and pursuing innovative grants and awards. Indicators, so how do we know that we've achieved those strategies just mentioned? Well, each building will rate as high-performing or exceptional on the Iowa Report Card by 2022. The second one, add advanced placement courses in calculus, chemistry, organic chemistry, and studio art by 2020. And we have a plan to roll those out over the course of the next 3 years. Eighth grade student option for high school credit courses. That was part of the motivation behind putting in a single campus. Growing our innovative programs, and we have a number of those throughout the district. Standards-based grading at Charles City High School by 2020, and there's a process and a plan in place to achieve that. We go to the red portion of that graphic, culture, climate, and environment. So the strategies are to promote positivity via the Orange Frog program, enhance positive behavior interventions and supports, and nurtured heart, two other programs that we have in place to really get a culture, climate, and environment. Promote student participation in one or more activities. Mr. Wolf is notorious for presenting to the board that we've hit 83% or 83.5% of students involved in at least one activity in school. And we know that students who are involved and engaged in school then perform better at school. Exploring the Leader in Me program for grades K through 8. If we're looking at a way to really improve the culture and climate, here's a program that has had an excellent track record. Finally, enhancing the onboarding of new staff members. And we've done this as an administrative team, but how can we continue to enhance that process for bringing on new teachers and support staff members? Indicators of success? Well, the high school graduation rate and the K-12 attendance rate would be at or above 95%. Office referrals and suspensions and expulsions would decline each year. The two-year staff retention rate, and that's a component of the Iowa School Report Card, will be at 85% or higher. One of the questions on our community needs assessment says, staff in the Charles City Community School District engage, inspire, and empower students in order to maximize learning. We want at least 75% or higher of our middle and high school students to either agree or strongly agree to that statement. We'd like 75% or more of our parents to rate the Charles City Schools as good or excellent on that needs assessment, and then 85% or higher of 712 students involved in one or more activities. Green, the effective communication component of the strategic plan graphic. So strategies, expand our presence on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. Develop a presence on new large-scale social media platforms that may not even exist right now. The admin team members will make presentations to civic, community, and church groups to share information and seek input. I have up here conduct a needs assessment in 2018, 2020, and 2022. And that the school board would increase its presence throughout the district on an annual basis. So what do those strategies look like? I've chosen some indicators of success for the social media. Please let me know if this is hitting at what you wanted or if there's a different way to measure that you would prefer. So interactions with stakeholders on Facebook or shares, Twitter retweets, and YouTube views will increase. The administrative team collectively will make 10 presentations or more each year to civic community and church groups. We would receive at least 800, 1,000, and 1,200 completed needs assessment surveys in 2018, 2020, and 2022 respectively. And maybe that's something you'd like to see annually instead of every 2 years. That's a part of this process for you to help refine the strategic plan. Hold at least one board meeting in Floyd and Caldwell each year. Fiscal responsibility and stability, pretty straightforward. Modify expenses in relationship to certified enrollment and use 5-year projections to detect trends earlier. And that would look like the unspent authorized budget being in the 5 to 15% range as recommended by the Iowa Association of School Boards. Salaries and benefits need to remain attractive to prospective employees. I referenced at the beginning that there are big changes coming in collective bargaining. With that, we still have to keep in mind that this has to be an attractive place to come, or we're not going to have staff members here in Charles City. Finally, the purple fifth area, facilities for educational excellence. Strategies. Engage the public to determine what upgrades or renovations would be supported in a referendum. Acquire and construct extracurricular and fine arts facilities that meet the needs of our students. Sell the North Grand building. Determine a long-term location for the district office, Cary Lane, homeschool assistants, and the Iowa Big North programs. And then develop a long-range plan for improvements at the elementary school level. The indicators of success. A supermajority of the voters approve a bond referendum. Baseball and softball fields are built on land that is out of the floodplain. A new auditorium is built at the 512 complex. The North Grand building is sold either for residential or civic use. We found a long-term location for district office, Cary Lane, homeschool, and Iowa Big North by 2020. And by 2022, we convene a task force to develop a long-range plan for elementary education in the Charles City Community School District. So those are your five areas. Open it up for questions or comments.
I like the development of the measurables, what I call things that can be measured, you know, success versus failure, and more easily identify ways to reach those. You know, if we have areas where we don't succeed, and areas that we do succeed, how we can expand upon that and make them more successful or translate those to other areas on here. So I think that's a big positive, and something that we continue to look at and refine maybe, but it's a very, very good start. Good spot.
Definitely a very well-rounded strategic plan. Thank you for using the information that was collected and putting together such a great presentation.
Anyone think we need to have additional input or offer revisions, or are we going to move forward with what's presented?
I think it looks great. You know, I like it's easy for us to follow, it's easy for the public to follow. I think it it also is a good outline, too, for anybody who's coming to Charles City that wants to see what we're all about and to see such aggressive goals in all five areas. I think it speaks a lot. Very good.
Any refinements in some of those measurables? Jason, you've talked about two-way dialogue, but
yeah,
is what you saw either the sharing or retweeting or
yeah,
the views on videos, does that help get at it?
It does.
It's hard to measure how many people post comments or
yeah, very much so
engage you. So
one of the things I've talked about in the past is trying to generate as much engagement as possible from us as board members with not only the community, but maybe even our staff too. If there are different ways that we can build on that, whether that is officially saying that we're going to host some town hall type meetings, maybe that's something that goes in with the standing committee edition that is in here with the policy committee that we're talking about in agenda item 11. So maybe something that's built into there, but maybe that's something that also could go easily into this, into some of the measurable things on here. But beyond that, it's a good start. I think it's a good, and most things are good as they are.
What about the needs assessment every 2 years? You want to see it yearly? Is every 2 years frequent enough?
2 years is often enough.
2 years seems...
In 1 year, can you see the results of what you changed?
Yeah.
Sure.
I would
be concerned if we did it on a yearly basis too, possibly our answers becoming stagnant.
Okay.
I think there's potential of that to
The participants dropping because...
Yes, because here we go again. Did we just do this again? Or is this a repeat?
It's a lot of work, too.
Yes.
You know, so...
On administration's part, it's
every other year that allows us to implement things.
Yeah.
You know, one idea I had under communication is that, I don't know, you know, we have a lot of major employers here in the community, and we know that not all of the employees live in Charles City, and so I'm wondering how it is that we can communicate better with those employees. I mean, I know we've got the Charles City Press and we have a whole lot of outreach, but is there any way that we can communicate directly to those employees through a Cambridge newsletter? Or through, you know, I don't even know what the what's possible, but what started me thinking about this is that I see where Simply Essential is having a job fair in Cedar Falls coming up. You know, they're recruiting all these workers they need. And so if they're recruiting down in Cedar Falls, why aren't we standing there in the booth with them, with Simply Essential, saying, hey, if you come to work at Simply Essential, let us tell you about our school district. And, you know, this is what we're doing. Here's a slideshow. And this is who the Charles City Schools are.
Maybe more even broadening that with a connection with economic development or something.
Yeah, exactly.
That, like we did with when Mark Wixman was down to the Capitol last year, maybe formalizing that partnership a little more strongly. And like you said, it's whether that's a totally a connection with the administration and them and doing it, or even, like I said, I feel like we should be out maybe more in the public's eye, taking comment. I mean, so people
members.
Can say, yeah, as board members. I mean, they elect us to do the job. Being more available for that stuff.
In high B.
Yeah, exactly.
On a Sunday morning or Saturday morning, I guess, you know.
I would say that, too, would be the only area in this, in the whole thing, is I feel like we need to be tasked as board members more in this area.
So that bottom bullet, the school board will increase its presence throughout the district on an annual basis on the strategies under effective communication.
The indicators you have listed aren't sufficient to
hold us accountable.
Hold us accountable for it.
Yeah.
Give us something.
So, in addition to one board meeting in Floyd and Cowell, and you'd like another indicator more specific to board member visibility.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that could come out of this, like I said, the
standing
the communications and public relations committee. I mean, if there's a there's an appointment to that committee, then maybe that. The responsibilities that come with that committee position include representing the board at a coffee or something, or whatever that may be. I don't know.
What do you think?
Listening post things like that.
Do you think regular radio?
Yeah.
Because it's.
And all of those things have been discussed or thrown around, hashed around over the last year or two. We just. Need to actually
formalize
it and act upon it.
Yeah.
How do you judge the results of the extra labor and whatever else to have the meeting of Floyd and Cowell if nobody else shows up there? They must be all they come to.
Well, it's, you know, hopefully that.
So how do we know if that's doing us any good or not? You know, what is it?
No, as though there's ever going to be anything measurable there, but it's a nice gesture.
Well, it's a nice gesture, but maybe once a year is enough. Maybe we need to go twice a year.
Oh, I see.
So if they don't show up the first time, they can come the next time.
And the problem we had last year, we did both of those meetings in the winter when it was icy and snowy and cold both nights.
Right.
And so now we're going to attempt it when
spring,
the weather's a little better.
But communities, both of them, make the later
and
fall.
Yeah, and even so, Caldwell was very welcoming and folks there.
Yes,
and
the whole meeting was nice.
And it's very late.
Right. Good question.
And sometimes those things are difficult to judge or value, but I think it's important for us to make the gesture and continue to making the gesture. And somebody will come forward in the future. So you're going to take this back then and do a little refinement?
I can do some refinement.
On the...
Bring it back to 23rd.
Okay.
Looks great. It is very...
First door is fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah, the structure's really good. It flows very nicely.
I read it right away and then read it again, driving home from Omaha and both times. I just felt like it was... It clearly states where we're headed, and as Lorraine said, I would be proud to offer this to somebody looking to make Charles City keep. This is a piece of...
Well, and you know, if we're getting into school vouchers and school choice, you know, this is a piece that can proudly tell anyone who we are and our competitive difference and our story. So.
Something we could print 1,000 copies at and drop from an airplane.
That's right.
Yeah. There you go.
Print this.
Yeah. But realistically, it is something that we can provide to our employers in town. They can be provided to prospective employees.
The chamber.
The chamber.
What are charter schools?
They are independent schools set up typically by private corporations, run for a profit. Now in Iowa there are three, and they're not, because in Iowa they have to be run by a school district, and the regulations are pretty tight. What we all are anticipating will happen is that it will be loosened as part of the bigger movement at the federal and state level.
Just one of the church schools.
Yeah.
So if there's nothing else, we're just going to let this go back to administration and they'll bring it back in 2 weeks, because that was the goal in the last sentence anyway, is to have it back to us for approval at the next board meeting.
Yes.
Okay. Agenda item phase two. Agenda item 10 is phase two process. So we have information on that in our handouts.
So I've given you a very tentative, highlighted, underlined process for the next 3 months. I'm sorry, there is no visual to go with this, so you'll have to just listen as I speak. There are, and this is in consultation with BLDD Architects with Gene Underwood. So determining an educational leadership team is something that will happen between today and basically the end of the month. It's 8 to 12 teachers and administrators, potentially one or two board members as part of that process. The next thing that would happen would be pretty much next week is the tentative timeline, draft process activities, participants, and time frame. And Buildings and Grounds, we'll discuss that tomorrow. We have a menu of options from which to choose about what we'd like BLDD to do versus what we would do. And so we'll talk about that in the morning. Toward the end of the month, maybe from the 16th to the 27th, it's developing educational needs assessment. That's something that Mr. Johnson and I do on a conference call with BLDD to kind of go through and finalize some things. The CLIO analysis, which Director Winterink had asked about at a previous board meeting, can't be done until Estes does the physical needs assessment. So I'm guessing that that'll happen sometime at the end of January through maybe the 10th of February, sort of that window. Public input, those town hall meetings or information sessions, social media engagement, soliciting feedback through Facebook and Twitter. I'm guessing will take place between about February 13th and March 24th. So about a 6 week period there. At the same time, I have five trips that are tentatively identified. One that's a day trip, up and back. Three that involve one overnight stay, and one that involves a two-night stay. Nothing scheduled. I've put some things together, but I want to have a chance to kind of bounce that idea off of our high school administrator to see what he may have in mind as places to visit. And then any other folks, Jean as well, I haven't shown her that list, to say, all right, can we kind of hit the major places that we should go visit. By March 27th, which is 11 weeks from now, I'd like to assess where we are in the process. We have a board meeting that night, so that would be a good opportunity to hear reports from the site visits and determine what our next steps are. Those five visits, I've had the question asked already, are the people who are part of that 8 to 12 member team going to all five sites? I would say no. It's far too much to ask of those people. They may go to two of them, certainly will go to one of them, but I see that as kind of splitting up and saying, I'd like to go here, I'd like to go there. Maybe we pull in, bless you, a couple of other folks who take part in a site visit, and their responsibility when they come back from that site visit is to prepare a report of, here's what we saw, here are the types of spaces. We would recommend to the board further study of X, Y, and Z, and then we take that information in late March and kind of proceed from there. You would, given the directive of, let's not set a definite end date, let's assess where we are through the process. I'm hoping that 11 weeks in, we should have an idea of, are we going too fast or too slow? So, tentative.
And those reports that people come back and develop and share would be probably similar to the way, Lorraine, we did things when we took our other visits and all of the pictures on smartphones and downloading them and typing up something or sharing information that way. Pictures are worth, or a picture's worth a thousand words, so, and we definitely were able to share those spaces and visions 3 years ago on our trips with pictures, and so that'll be easy for them to do.
The educational leadership team, would it be appropriate to have a community member or two involved in something like that, or are we going to simply take most of their input through the community engagement part of that with the public input and town hall meetings and different things? Is there a benefit to that?
Probably going to have five or six high school teachers. We'll have high school principals, so now we're pretty much at six, and superintendent at seven. One board member, eight, or two makes nine. So it could be that. It could be a couple of community members. This was the recommendation from the architect. Yeah. It's certainly nothing more than a recommendation. We'd like to have a couple of community members be part of that smaller team. We know there's going to be a larger group looking and giving input, but that's kind of proceed how you'd like to go.
And primarily that would be an educational leadership team. So if somebody from the community were to come on board, they would need to probably be available for lots of conversations.
Sure.
Discussing educational opportunities that can exist in having a successful phase two.
I just don't think it can be understated how critical the community involvement in this process should be if we're going to meet the end goal of a past bond and that. So going through this, looking at the timeline, in my opinion, having those town hall meetings are critical, the social media stuff, all that. I see that as a kind of a two-part thing. Up front, gathering the input of what they want to see and what they support. And then after we get to a certain point, okay, here's what we've spit out, and then re-engaging them to, okay, yes, we support that, or no, we don't, or refinement of that as well, which I would expect to go beyond, down here, this assess where you're at in the process.
Yeah, I would think all of those things would happen at that time.
I would think the first four or five meetings, eight or nine people at a time, would be plenty until we get it down, maybe the last two or three, and then take a bigger number of people to the location that time to return with it. I think the original scouting one would probably be.
You're talking the visits to the
site visits?
Site visits.
If you're taking overnight trips, it'll probably be
one time.
Yeah, and one trip, and we didn't really have a lot of people go with us when we took our other trips, and
like the second time we went back to...
When we went to Independence the second day.
The second time, we had a lot more people.
On that very cold day in January? Yeah.
I don't think it was as good a meeting as it was the first time, it was less of us.
Well, it was quite an agenda, you know?
Right.
And so, you know, I can remember about six people who were always coming to those meetings and during those visits with us. I don't know that we feel that right now.
Given the distance of some of the locations that I've identified, I don't see more than one van going to each of the locations, so it would be a little more helpful to have probably 12 people, closer to 12 rather than closer to 8. Because if we're going to divide up and go to maybe two locations each, there aren't enough folks if we only have 8. You're going to end up going to basically all of the spots, and I don't know how many people can really give up that much time away from students, away from other responsibilities, away from families to do that. So maybe we do look at having 3 or 4 community members.
And I think that that's something, and like you said, someone, community members that are willing to take that information back and represent the community type of thing as well. So.
Well, and when we did our visits before, we had a press writer in the company.
Who went with us.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And Kate may have to jump in the van real quick and do some of those trips too, so it was very helpful.
I mean, come on, Pastor. But as far as the board, we would be going on most of all of the trips together. Maybe we don't need all of those. Maybe we all don't need to go on some of the overnights, but we would be going on the majority of those trips, right?
There's only one.
Just one or two of us?
Yeah, and it's only one day trip.
Mm-hmm. One day trip, we could all go on that day trip.
If you post it as a board meeting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think we should. Because, you know, we're talking about a substantial investment, we're talking about a radical project here. You know, this is a big goal, and we've got to get it right, and I think we owe it to ourselves to see as much of it as we can together.
So, Buildings and Grounds is going to discuss the draft process, activities, etc.
Which is the menu of options.
The menu of options.
That the board might wish to choose money to spend on as part of the whole process versus having staff do it at no cost or at internal cost.
And Dr. Cox has shared that list with me already, so I'm familiar with what they're going to take a look at. And you'll see that tomorrow, and depending upon how Buildings and Grounds turns out, we need to have a finance committee meeting soon anyway, Lorraine.
So well, we were waiting on our numbers to roll in, but it sounds like that's taking longer than we expected.
Which numbers?
Oh, on the assessments.
Oh.
The final phase one.
Oh, yeah. I would think that in the next 2 weeks.
Yeah.
They meet tomorrow. We could meet within the next 10 days and come back for the 23rd and get moving on this. Okay, this was just an information item only. So we'll move on to agenda item 11, standing committee addition. You want to discuss this a little bit, Dr. Pratt?
Sure. So we've got some major changes coming. As I've referenced already, Betsy DeVos's nomination as Secretary of Education, a whole shift in Republican control of the House and Senate, and the renewed interest in vouchers and charter schools and educational savings accounts, all that diverts money away from public education. So the strategic plan has this new focus area, effective communication. I had visited with the board president. Is it time to add another standing committee? I know we just brought the policy back a month ago, but given the big shift in the landscape. Is it time for us to have a standing committee on communications and public relations? We're embarking on a pretty ambitious project with the high school. Everything else that's going on. Now, like all standing committees, the role would be to provide big picture guidance, so this is not for board members to be doing the work, but to provide direction as to how the work should be done. And that's administration and staff who carry out that day-to-day work. So what are your collective thoughts as board members about having an additional standing committee? And then the follow-up would be, which two of you, if we send this back to the policy committee to bring you an addition, which two of you might have interest, or do you want to wait till the 23rd?
Are there other districts that have communication and public relations committees? Have you seen policies dealing with this?
I could not tell you without doing some intentional looking.
Okay.
Yeah, so what would a meeting of this committee look like? You mean like an agenda?
Right now, with the phase two processes going forward, an agenda on an effective communications and public relations committee would say, all right, here are the things that I want to see us doing as a district over the next 3 months. I'd like to have materials printed at major employers, because I think that would be important. I'd like us to explore having a presence with major employers at job fairs. I'd like to make sure that we have X number of pieces that appear in the press or on the radio station that talk about what we're doing. That might be one thing. When we get to our lobbying date, which is January 31st, the Communications and Public Relations Committee might be the ones that says, all right, let's talk about what we're going to leave behind with the legislators. Do we want to leave just one sheet like we've done before? Do we want to have an invitation to them to come to Charles City? What do we want to make sure that, you know, administration and Justin, as part of his role with communications, prepares for us so that we're ready as a board to do that? Those would be two different types of things that I would see this committee providing guidance for. Right now, it's just left to kind of what I think is best, what Justin thinks is best, and we can keep doing that if that's working. If you think it's time to have a committee, then let's explore that as well.
And remember that this would be big picture items. And sometimes I can see where superintendent, administration, even our communications person, you get wrapped up in your daily activities that you don't see some things or see parts of the picture or the puzzle. And that's where, you know, hopefully we could see a part of the puzzle that might be missing, mm-hmm. or give guidance to refocus or redirect. Because it is difficult when you get wrapped in the day-to-day functions of everything you do to see all of the different parts of the puzzle.
Yeah, I mean, I think that Justin and Dr. Cox, you've both been doing a very good job with the communications and PR that we've had. But I could see where, you know, maybe two heads, three heads, four heads are better than one for, you know, depth of ideas, where it could be beneficial. And something like this committee, it would fit me like a hand in glove with, you know, my profession, and I'd be willing to help out with this. But if we should decide that we wanted to do something such as this.
Yeah.
But, it might be a good time to do that, because we have a bond that we'll need to pass eventually. And we need to be real strategic about our communication leading up to that, too.
Could it also be part of this committee to help establish what we as a board want to say in unity, too? We're not only giving you your big picture outlook or direction, but could you not also set it up for us, too, for when it comes time, particularly in the bond, so that we have the information is all laid out, so that we all have the same story we talked about in the government, the other districts. One of the most important things, that everybody has the same story, we're all on the same page, and we're all giving the same answer.
Same pitch.
Sure. So is this something you'd like the policy committee to go back and do the research on and come up with something?
Yeah.
Is there a motion?
Motion to direct the policy committee members to bring a revised standing committee policy at the next board meeting that includes a communications and public relations committee.
Seconded.
It's been moved and seconded to approve agenda item 11 as recommended by administration. Any other comments or discussion from the board? Any comments or questions from the public? Hearing none, we'll have roll call vote, please.
Bisbee?
Yes.
Maycomer?
Yes.
Wintering?
Yes.
Walker?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes. Yes. Motion carried, 5-0. Agenda item 12, athletic complex land purchase. We have a brief update from Dr. Cox.
Yeah, brief, and the news that you've been waiting for. I would anticipate having January 23rd an agreement to submit to the board for your consideration for the acquisition of some land for baseball and softball fields. We've all been patiently waiting. It's been a long process, but there just have been several things that had to be asked about by the proposed seller and then kind of come to an agreement. And so I'm pleased to be able to share that we are in the last stage of this agreement. And so, yeah.
Yes. Okay. Excellent. Thank you for that uplifting report.
That was a little short.
Agenda item 13, audit report for 2015-16. Mrs. O'Brien, you want to pass this on down to Terry so she can do the PowerPoint and do her presentation for us.
Okay, this will be another brief report. It is very similar. I'm just going to go through the outlines of additional information besides what you've already heard about in the CAR, because the financial information has not changed. So we're going to talk about the auditor's opinion of our financial statement. So, our audit opinion just said that in all material aspects, our financial statements are presented fairly. And it doesn't sound like much, but this is the highest opinion you can get with an audit opinion, because they don't look at all transactions, they look at a sample of transactions and give an opinion. There is in the audit report, which is in addition to what you see in the CAR, they talk about, like in the management discussion and analysis, financial highlights and economic factors bearing on the district's future. And in our audit report, we have the following, or these economic factors. One on enrollment decline and how that affects our financial statements. We talked about middle school, single campus, secondary efficiencies that we gained from building a middle school attached to the high school. That we hope to sell the North Brand building. We also talk about phase two project investigations, that we're also looking at a large project for high school renovation. And lastly, positive note that Simply Essentials, you know, has come to town and may employ additional people and hopefully increase our enrollment. And this is just kind of parts of the audit report. You got your financial statements, notes to the financial statements, supplemental information, and then the audit findings. So those are the different sections. And then lastly, we talked about the schedule of findings, which everybody's probably most interested in. We did exceed our budget in one section of our certified budget, which is the support services area. We did not exceed it in total, just that particular section. And that was due to the fact that we had that district-wide LEP lamp expense. We had revenue, but they don't look at revenue in the certified budget. We added this expense, should have amended the budget in that area, but that was one. And then certified enrollment, we overstated by 0.1 student in the fall of 2015 count. And then lastly, our FFA grant was recorded in the activity fund instead of the PEPL fund. The state has certain wants that if you get this particular grant, it's supposed to be in that fund. And that's it.
Any questions or comments for Mrs. O'Brien?
Good, good.
Good job, yeah.
Excellent work by you and your staff to keep things on the up and up and tidy and everything ready for them. Is there a motion to approve and accept the audit report?
I'll make a motion to approve the 6/30/16 audit report as presented.
I'll second it.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the audit report as presented. Any other comments from the board? Any comments or questions from the public? Hearing none, we'll have roll call vote, please.
Maycomber?
Yes.
Wintering?
Yes.
Walker?
Yes.
Frisbee?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes. Motion carried 5-0. Agenda item 14, financial report for December of 2016.
In the financial reports, our year is halfway over. It's hard to believe. everything is looking good. I mean, our cash is above where we were at this point last year. Our revenue is ahead of where we were at this time last year, or against projected, and expenses are under. So our cash is increasing. But a budget, you know, in the budget, some things were budgeting at an even spending of certain categories throughout the year, which isn't going to happen. And there is a lot of carryover funds that we just won't budget or won't spend, probably end up carrying over, you know, that same categorical funds again. We did receive our rebate for Mid-America, so we got the check.
Okay,
good.
And in our office, we're currently working on Obamacare and those reporting requirements that go along with it. And hopefully, within the next two meetings, we'll have a final middle school construction budget where we can say, okay, this is where we ended up.
Motion to accept the December 2016 financial reports as presented.
I'll second it.
It's been moved and seconded to accept the December 16 financial reports as presented. Any other questions or comments from the board? Any questions or comments from the public? None, we'll have roll call vote, please.
Wintering?
Yes.
Walker?
Yes.
Frisbee?
Yes.
May Cumber?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes, motion carried 5-0. Agenda item 15, the consent agenda as amended. Is there a motion?
Motion to approve the consent agenda as amended.
I'll second it.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the consent agenda as amended. Roll call vote, please.
Walker?
Yes.
Frisbee?
Yes.
May Cumber?
Yes.
Wintering?
Yes.
Dyke?
Yes, motion carried 5-0. Agenda item 16, correspondence for miscellaneous. Do we have anything?
Nothing tonight. Do we anticipate getting the enrollment summary monthly again soon?
We were expecting that.
Yeah.
And it didn't show up.
It did not show up.
Okay. That would be nice to see.
If available. Possible. We're trying to make it more.
You can't. The information is the information. You just have to put it on the form. Agenda item 17, important upcoming dates.
SIAC Wednesday, again, 5 o'clock in the Iowa Big North classroom. No school next Monday. Saturday the 21st, district large group speech is at Waverly Shell Rock. Board meeting here on the 23rd. Conference wrestling at Waukon the 28th. And again, the school board goes to Des Moines on Tuesday, January 31st.
And any dates of any webinars and things that come up? You'll note those?
Are they published? Yes.
I think there's something coming up in February.
I think so.
Having no other business to come before the board, we will adjourn at 7:52 p.m.